Okay, we'll get started. Well, welcome. This will be a part one of a five-part series where we're going to look at the meteorology behind severe thunderstorms, specifically tornado forecasting, looking at mesocyclonic tornadoes and non-mesocyclonic tornadoes, some of the parameter development, and the conceptual models that these parameters are built upon. So again, this is part one of a five-part series, and we will cover just the basics of supercells to begin with. So again, we have learning objectives here. This is primarily, we want you to be able to identify the key physical characteristics that are associated with supercells, and using a hodograph and potentially an entire sounding profile, be able to determine which characteristics are more probable. So keep that in mind. So hopefully everybody's familiar with the supercell thunderstorm. This is just a series of images from work that's been done over the last 30 to 40 years, much of it here in the United States. The characteristic supercell, the Browning model, which came out in the mid-60s, but this was updated by Doswell and Lemon in the late 70s. Characteristic hook echo shape, mesocyclone. The mesocyclone is what we're going to focus on today because that is the primary defining characteristic of a supercell thunderstorm. And as you can see from the images on the bottom, these storms are responsible for very large hail production, some of the most intense tornadoes on record, and quite a bit of damage potential. So they're a big societal concern, so it's very important to understand how to forecast these events properly. Okay, what makes a supercell? Again, we're starting from the baseline that you have some meteorology background. So here, when we talk about buoyancy, this would be convective available potential energy, just a measure of the energy available for an updraft in a thunderstorm if it's all released through latent heat. Vertical wind shear. So we need something to provide the source of rotation for the deeper updraft, and we're going to talk about that in some detail here today. And this is a function of the hodograph, the shape and length of the hodograph, and as you can see from the sub-bullets, the straight hodograph, we're going to explain why it favors splitting storms with both mirror image left and right movers, and then we'll talk about the curved hodograph, and specifically the clockwise turning hodograph that favors cyclonic or right-moving supercells in the northern hemisphere. And then, of course, it does matter whether you get linear convection versus more discrete modes. If you're trying to forecast supercells and specifically tornadoes, it makes a difference. Okay, why does mid-level rotation matter? Well, first of all, a rotating updraft is actually stronger than a non-rotating updraft, specifically below the level of maximum rotation. This is related to pressure perturbations that develop in response to the rotation. The storm actually draws air in from below. So with that drawing the air in from below, as we will talk about a little later, that's related to stretching potential. So we can create, due to the storm dynamics, a stronger updraft lower in the troposphere, and that is actually helpful for tornado genesis. Again, rotating updrafts tend to persist longer. They're resistant to decay, and you end up with a longer-lived storm, which gives you more opportunities to produce tornadoes. Okay, here's just a little simple animation. This is from Comet, and you can look at the left. There's a just characteristic sort of a low precipitation type rotating updraft associated with this right-moving supercell. On the right, we are showing just a simple illustration of the tilting argument of an updraft acting on background horizontal vorticity. So the idea is the right-hand rule is if you look at the vertical wind profile on the right, you could assume this would be like easterly low-level winds quickly turning to westerly aloft. If you were to use your fingers on your hand, go back to physics and look at the right-hand rule, your fingers point in the direction of the vertical shear, which in this case, if you plot this as a hodograph, is from the west to the east. So the winds are changing with height, becoming more westerly. Your thumb would point into the screen with that profile. So the right-hand rule, the vorticity vector, would be your thumb pointing into the screen. In this case, it's a two-dimensional rendering of that. You see the vortex tube, the vortex line is oriented into the screen, and we see an updraft tilting it. But you notice what happens on the flanks of the updraft. The tilting reorients the vorticity that was originally horizontal into the vertical, and now you have cyclonic and anticyclonic rotation on either flank of the storm. This becomes important because the pressure perturbations associated with that weak rotation, that's what eventually leads to storm propagation. So what we'll do is we'll look at that in my cartoonish version of the same thing. Here's the same kind of wind profile. In this case, the right-hand rule, your fingers curl toward the right of the screen in the direction of the vertical shear as you move upward in height, and the vorticity vector would be into the screen. So you think of a paddle wheel in that sort of flow regime. It would spin, it would roll clockwise off to the right is the way the sensor rotation would be. In that case, now we go to look at this from above. This is my fancy thunderstorm updraft. As you can tell, it looks just like the real world, or at least I hope you can see that. Again, on either flank, we've tilted the vorticity. We're looking at it from above. We actually have cyclonic rotation on the right flank with this particular wind profile and anticyclonic on the left flank of the storm. And this is the mean wind. In this case, we could interpret it as from the west. We move forward. Our storm is just moving with the mean wind. We haven't done anything supercellular yet, but we've started to see the influence of the pressure perturbations. We have a weak low on the right flank. This, what does this do? This actually helps induce new updrafts beneath that pressure perturbation. It's drawing air in from below. It's not very strong to start with because it's just on the flank of the updraft. But it's a little bit of a boost on that flank, and as soon as you get updraft development co-located with the pressure perturbation, you see new updraft development right there. That's what you start to recognize as propagation to the right, and the exact same thing is happening to the left. So this is your storm split argument. Okay, so straight hodograph case, it's the deep layer vertical shear provides the horizontal vorticity, certainly in the low levels, that can be tilted and stretched. Initially, the rotation is weak on either flank of the updraft. It draws air in from below, but then it co-locates the updraft. And the way we would describe that is the vorticity goes from crosswise to streamwise. So we'll demonstrate that with some hodographs and the vector orientations coming up. And again, you end up with stronger rotation, more persistent updrafts, and longer lived storms, which present more of a severe weather hazard for everything from tornadoes to large hail damaging winds, flash floods, you name it. Okay, so here's a real world example. And we don't always have to pick the classic cyclonic surface-based storm. This is gonna be a left split elevated storm. So this one's a little harder to find. This is a case where the updraft is rooted around 850 millibars, you can see from the parcel trace, relatively large buoyancy, and looks like deep layer west or west-northwesterly shear. Here's the hodograph associated with that sounding profile. And what I've done is we've highlighted the mean wind, so we're talking about an initial updraft. It's going to move more or less with the mean wind. So in this case, it would be to the east-southeast at 35 to 40 knots. Now the vorticity vector, remember the right-hand rule, a hodograph, you're going up in height with the plot. So in this case, the zero, that little, just to the upper left of the origin, that's the surface wind. And then we're just plotting the endpoints of all the wind vectors as we move up. So in this case, starting from about, if you can see the little one near the base of the arrow that I've got highlighted, your fingers, the vertical shear vector, is along the hodograph. So it's pointing down toward the lower right. The right-hand rule gives you a vorticity vector pointing toward the upper right. In this case, the vorticity, and it's near 1 kilometer above the ground, which is near the storm inflow base, it's crosswise. Because if you look, compared to the storm relative wind with the starting storm motion, it's orthogonal. So these two, they're perpendicular to one another. The vorticity is across the storm motion. So in this case, you wouldn't expect direct updraft rotation. It would be on the flanks of the updraft. Okay, let's see what happened with radar. This is looking at lower elevation. Anyone's familiar with their geography, this is the Pleasant Hill radar site, so northwest Missouri. Moving along, you see evidence of the split process, except this is an elevated thunderstorm. And you notice the left mover has the characteristic supercell shape, except it's inverted from what you're normally used to seeing in the northern hemisphere for a right mover. The right mover actually looks somewhat anemic in this case. So this is a case where the left mover for an elevated storm is actually favored. So we continue. This is looking aloft. Now we're up closer to 15 to 20,000 feet above the ground. And you see the evidence of a much stronger, deeper updraft, higher reflectivity with the left mover, even evidence of a three-body scatter spike representing hail. And again, this just shows that the updraft is strengthening at the same time that we're getting the more characteristic anticyclonic lima bean shape with the storm. Okay, that's the hopefully a reasonable explanation of the splitting storms. Of course, when we're talking about tornadic thunderstorms, the curved hodograph becomes even more important, and we'll talk about that more in the upcoming parts of this series. But the curved hodograph is a little bit simpler to start with. In this case, the vorticity is initially streamwise. We don't have to go through any intermediate steps. The initial updraft can rotate cyclonically with a clockwise turning hodograph. And again, that will favor the right mover in the northern hemisphere immediately, which is the cyclonic storm. So we're going to illustrate that, show you what we mean. And if you happen to find a counterclockwise turning hodograph, it would favor the left mover. It's just thermodynamically, it's very difficult to do that because that's related to a cold advection regime. Okay, so here's much more typical supercell tornado type sounding profile, large buoyancy, strong vertical shear. This is actually the case from eastern Nebraska in June of 2014, the Pilger tornado day. This is a special sounding from Omaha that was fairly close in time and space. Okay, this one has, notice this isn't a straight hodograph. This is a very curved hodograph, and when we say clockwise with height is if you follow the red line up, it's curving in the clockwise direction as we move. Here, this is the initial mean wind. Storm is just moving to the northeast. Again, this is pre-supercellular structure. But if you look at the vorticity vector, use the right-hand rule, you're pointing toward the west in this case. The storm relative wind is in the same direction as that vorticity vector. This is an illustration of purely streamwise vorticity, and that's even for no propagation yet. This is just an updraft moving with the mean wind, has purely streamwise vorticity really close to the ground. This is only a few hundred meters off the ground if you plot the elevations there. So what happens in a case like this, you would expect the storm to rotate cyclonically very quickly after initiation. This is literally just 10 minutes on reflectivity. You see something, it's still got a little bit of a hook shape, and then aloft, you start to see a weak echo region, which is indicative of a strong updraft on that right flank of the storm. And then we look at the velocity plot, and we have weak cyclonic shear. 10 minutes later, we have a strong mesocyclone, all the way down just a couple of thousand feet off the ground. This is very rapid development. This is exactly what you would expect to see in a highly streamwise vorticity environment. So again, this is one where the initial updraft, the rotation is co-located with the updraft. If it's a strong updraft, it immediately stretches and amplifies the vorticity. Okay, so there are some other things to consider here. We've just talked about what in the environment supports supercell formation. The question is formation the same as persistence or storm dissipation? This is a tough question. Anybody wants to do some work on this problem? It's certainly ripe for investigation, but the answer appears to be yes. I say that in quotes because we don't have a real good feel. It certainly seems like it takes a different thermodynamic regime to get a supercell established compared to what it does to keep a storm going. You can have storms mature and then move into very low buoyancy environments with strong vertical shear and persist much longer than you would think they would. Okay, so we're going to just revisit the key points here for supercells, and just really the important thing to remember here is you need buoyancy for an updraft to get started. I mean, that's the whole key here. We're talking deep moist convection. And we need a source for vorticity, which is the low-level vertical shear. We didn't talk about it a great deal here, but it helps if the vertical shear is through a deep enough layer to keep precipitation away from the updraft so that the storm has a chance to persist. And then whether or not the rotation is on the flanks and results in propagation and stronger rotation versus initial updraft rotation just depends on the shape of the hodograph. So again, the straight hodograph, splitting storms, the curved hodograph gives you almost immediate updraft rotation. And again, it's just a matter of which way the hodograph's curved and what the local storm environment looks like.